episode of Patient Pulse. NATF is excited to kick off a three-part series on women's heart health, a critical topic in cardiovascular medicine. We're delighted to welcome Dr. Annabel Santos-Foldman to deliver the first installment of this talk on heart disease in women and its link to blood clots. Dr. Foldman is the co-founder and medical director of the Rush Heart Center for Women, the first heart program in Chicago devoted exclusively to women. She's a professor in clinical cardiology at Rush and a nationally recognized leader in cardiology care and research. She is a fellow of the American College of Cardiology and the American Heart Association, and she's also a prominent leader in the American Heart Association's Go Red for Women campaign that aims to inform women about cardiovascular disease risk and the actions they can take to protect their health. So welcome, Dr. Foldman. We're excited to have you, and take it away.
Thank you, Aviva. I am delighted to be here today. I have been a medical director of the Rush Heart Center for Women for 17 years, and I'm a cardiac electrophysiologist by training, but currently I take care of patients, especially women, to prevent and treat heart disease. These are my disclosures, although I don't have any conflict of interest with this lecture. Today, I'm discussing cardiovascular disease in women, specifically heart attacks, strokes, and some cardiac manifestations of COVID-19. I thought that would be timely. The most common cause of heart attacks and strokes is plaque buildup in the arteries of the heart and brain. The buildup is due to the liver making too much cholesterol in the familial forms of hypercholesterolemia. Other causes of buildup are due to lifestyle choices, such as eating too much cholesterol that is found in all animal products, lack of physical activity, which leads to low HDL cholesterol. As you can see in the slide, this is the HDL cholesterol, and there are also LDL cholesterol and lipoprotein A that can cause this plaque buildup. If you are not exercising, your HDL is going to be low, and it's important to have high HDL cholesterol because that is the cholesterol that will pick up the LDL cholesterol in the bloodstream and take it back to the liver to make these important hormones that we all need. If there is too much LDL cholesterol or not enough HDL cholesterol, LDL cholesterol can go inside the arterial lining cells called the endothelial cells, these cells that line the blood vessels of the heart and brain, and this can build up over the decades, causing atherosclerosis. This top picture here depicts how the plaque can build up over decades, and at any point in this plaque buildup, if there is a lot of inflammation, such as what we see in infections or stress, the plaque can rupture like this. It looks like a volcano can rupture and cause a blood clot to form and block the artery completely. And this is what we call a thrombosis or a blood clot. As you can see, there will no longer be any blood flowing into the heart muscle. When you form this blood clot, such as what happens in a heart attack, or if the artery is in the brain, it can cause a stroke. Now, these blood clots can break off and actually go further into the artery, causing an embolism. And these embolisms are blood clots that can break off from different parts of the body, such as the left atrium, such as what we see in atrial fibrillation. The blood clots in the left atrium can break off and go into the brain. Most of those blood clots can go into the brain and cause strokes. And that's why it's so important to prevent these blood clots from forming and breaking off. So how can doctors prevent this from happening? How do doctors calculate the risk of a heart attack, stroke, or even death? We're very fortunate that we now have a very good way to calculate the risk of heart disease in most people, age 40 to 79-year-old men and women. Although we do need some information to calculate the 10-year risk or lifetime risk, we use information such as the sex of the patient. Men have a higher risk of heart attacks, but women get heart attacks after the age of 65 as much as men. We also use age. We need the race of the patients. Blacks have a higher risk of heart attacks, and we also need total and HDL cholesterol. We need the blood pressure of the patient, mostly the systolic blood pressure, and a history of smoking and diabetes. If the 10-year risk score is greater than or equal to 7.5%, that is the 10-year risk If this number is greater than 7.5%, statins are recommended by doctors or nurse practitioners to decrease the risk of that patient having a heart attack, stroke, or death. If the risk is between 5 and 7.5%, there are other factors that can influence the decision to start statins, which are the only drugs that have consistently lowered the risk of strokes, heart attacks, and deaths in this disease. Since women are at a lower risk of heart attacks and often have scores that are less than 7.5%, we look at other conditions that are specific to women that were recently included in the guidelines that have been found to increase the risk. These include premature menopause and a history of pregnancy-associated disorders, such as pregnancy-related hypertension, preeclampsia, gestational diabetes, if the infants are small for their gestational age, or preterm deliveries. These are all risks that can increase the risk of heart attacks, strokes, and deaths in women. The other risk factors that are specific to women are lupus and rheumatoid arthritis, because women tend to have more autoimmune diseases. Those can also increase the inflammation in people. And so remember that inflammation causes that rupture in the plaque. I wanted to focus on the risk of strokes in women. This is the one problem that a lot of my patients are really fearful of. So we need to prevent strokes in everybody. But specifically in women, there are 55,000 more women who have strokes every year than men. Women have a higher lifetime risk of stroke than men. And the sex-specific incidence rates between 1993, 1994, and 2010 declined significantly for men, but not for women. We're trying to reverse this trend. Atrial fibrillation is such an important and most common arrhythmia that we see in cardiology. And the stroke mortality or the death risk when somebody has a stroke is higher in women than in men. With atrial fibrillation, the risk of stroke is markedly increased. And female sex is considered a risk factor in the scoring algorithm that we use to calculate the risk of stroke in these patients. So we use this calculation to determine the risk of stroke when a patient has atrial fibrillation called the CHA2DS2-VASc score. Strokes occur when a blood clot comes from the left atrium, the upper chamber of the heart, and breaks off and goes to the brain. We use information about the sex, age, history of hypertension, history of strokes, whether they have diabetes or atherosclerosis, to determine if the patient would benefit from the use of oral anticoagulants such as warfarin and the newer anticoagulants such as you can see here, dabigatran, rivaroxaban, apixaban, or edoxaban. These are more commonly known as Eliquis, Xarelto, dabigatran is Pradaxa, and Cevesa is edoxaban. This is a summary slide of the unique characteristics of atrial fibrillation in women. Not only do women have a higher risk of stroke than men, these strokes are more severe. Women are treated more than men with drugs such as digoxin that are associated with breast cancer and mortality. Women are also referred less for curative procedures such as catheter ablation, and women are less likely to be given drugs to prevent strokes. Even on warfarin, women have a higher risk of stroke than men, but this is not seen with the new oral anticoagulants. In addition, major bleeding on the new oral anticoagulants is less than on warfarin. So overall, women are better off on these new oral anticoagulants. Unfortunately, women often can't afford these new drugs, or their insurance won't pay for these more expensive drugs. When patients can't be on these anticoagulants due to bleeding, we use a device called the Watchman device that can be placed in the appendage of the left atrium. We put this umbrella-like device to prevent the blood clots that are forming here. I want to briefly talk about the use of aspirin for prevention of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease in women, because there's been a lot of new information and new guidelines that have been out there. And we recently wrote the summary of updated recommendations, and I wanted to show this slide because I thought it was such an easy slide to understand. So patients who have ever had a heart attack or a coronary heart disease or peripheral arterial disease, or if they've had a stroke or a TIA, they need to continue the aspirin indefinitely. Women who do not need aspirin are those who are healthy and have never had major cardiovascular risk factors. We are now telling our patients who are over the age of 70, who've never had a heart attack or stroke or do not have risk factors, to stop using their aspirin. Especially if they've had a prior risk for bleeding or bleeding, they should stop the aspirin. We don't know if aspirin is beneficial in people who are smokers or if they have elevated CAC score or coronary artery calcium score over 100 or if they have carotid plaque. These remain to be determined and remain to be studied. If they have a strong family history of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, we don't know if they benefit, or suboptimal controlled lipids or blood pressure, or if they have a high atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. We don't know in those people. But if you have had a heart attack or stroke, please continue your aspirin. Cardiology is really a fine balance of clotting and bleeding because blood clots are what causes heart attacks and strokes. And unfortunately, the treatment that we use to prevent those blood clots can cause bleeding, such as gastrointestinal bleeds, or worse, hemorrhagic strokes that can occur when patients who have aneurysms or their arteries cause a hemorrhagic strokes. So those are devastating strokes and they need immediate treatment. So I wanted to just briefly tell you about what we're seeing in COVID-19. Since we are seeing major consequences of blood clots all over the body when patients get infected with this coronavirus, we see blood clots in the lung arteries, heart arteries, and brain arteries. And there are studies ongoing right now that are looking into whether patients should be on drugs that decrease the platelet activity, such as aspirin or other stronger antiplatelet drugs, or blood clot drugs such as the oral anticoagulants or low molecular weight heparin. So these are ongoing right now, and we will be looking at these patients in the next few months to see if they benefit from these medications that can prevent blood clots. So I just wanted to summarize the key takeaways of my talk. Heart disease is the number one killer of women and men, and it is preventable. You need to know your personal risk. Knowing that is the first powerful and life-saving step to a healthy lifestyle. Improve your lifestyle with exercise, healthy eating habits, and of course, please do not smoke. Women often have barriers to these things, such as lack of time, money, or determination to eating healthy and exercise. Women don't always take care of themselves as much as they take care of other people. I often have to remind my patients that they have to take care of themselves first before they can take care of others. They have to make themselves a priority, and they would feel better if they can just be more active for about 30 minutes a day, either walking or gardening or doing something fun with their friends. Especially social distancing is important nowadays. Just moving is a great way to start a healthy lifestyle. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Boldman, for that wonderful overview. And thank you, everybody, for listening. And feel free to join us next month for another episode of Patient Pulse.